Welcome to the mini lesson on skeletal muscle relaxation. In this lesson, we will be talking about how to interrupt the crossbridge cycle. Of course, the crossbridge cycle is the mechanism by which a muscle contracts, generates force. So interrupting that process is what would lead to skeletal muscle relaxation. The diagram on the left shows the role of calcium ions in initiating the cross-bridge cycle. If you look at the diagram at the very top, what you'll see is the reddish-purple part of the drawing is representative of a myosin filament, and I'm highlighting that with the cursor right now. And of course, the projections, the myosin heads, extend from the myosin filament into this gap between the myosin and the actin. But the cross-bridge cycle is not proceeding in this picture because the myosin binding sites on the actin filament are actually covered up by this protein called tropomyosin. It is a filament-shaped protein that is wrapped in a spiral fashion around the actin in just such a way to cover up the myosin binding sites. Well, if adding calcium, you can see here is the calcium ion that's being added in to the process, those calcium ions will enter into the myofibrils, that is the bundles of actin and myosin filaments. The calcium binds to a protein called troponin, and the binding of calcium to troponin causes that protein to change shape, and that shape change in troponin causes a slight change in the shape of the tropomyosin, just enough for it to slide off of the myosin binding sites on the actin filament. Right here you can see the myosin binding sites are now exposed and the cross-bridge cycle can proceed, which results in the contraction of the muscle. So if adding calcium to the sarcomeres allows the cross-bridge cycle to proceed, logically the way to counteract the contraction, which would be relaxation, is to remove those calcium ions, and that's what happens right here. With the calcium ions removed, the tropomyosin slides back over those myosin binding sites, the cross-bridge cycle is interrupted, and the muscle is no longer generating force. It is relaxed. Remember that the calcium ions in a relaxed muscle are stored inside the sarcoplasmic reticulum, and part of the process in contracting the muscle is to allow those calcium ions to flow out of the sarcoplasmic reticulum, where they can get in and amongst the protein filaments, bind to the troponin, and cause the cross-bridge cycle to proceed, or allow the cross-bridge cycle to proceed. So logically, the counteraction to initiating contraction would be to remove those calcium ions and place them back in the sarcoplasmic reticulum. That would counteract the sequence of events that led to muscle contraction, and that naturally results in muscle relaxation. So to relax the muscle, the trick would be to put the calcium ions back where they came from, and that would be the sarcoplasmic reticulum. In addition to causing the muscle to relax, realize that this also sets the muscle up for a subsequent contraction, because the calcium is in the sarcoplasmic reticulum and can be released again when that muscle needs to contract again. So if you're going to place the calcium ions back into the sarcoplasmic reticulum, remove them from the sarcomeres, and allow the muscle to contract again, the first thing you have to do is close those ion channels through which the calcium left the sarcoplasmic reticulum in the first place. So the diagram that you see here shows a membranous structure, and remember that the membrane of the sarcoplasmic reticulum is very similar in structure to the plasma membrane or the cell membrane. Namely, you see that there is a phospholipid bilayer with proteins embedded in the membrane. And when the protein is in this particular shape, you can see that the pathway for the calcium to move through the tunnel and exit the sarcoplasmic reticulum, move from one side of the membrane to the other, is open. That gate is open. So if we're going to get the calcium stored back in the sarcoplasmic reticulum, the first thing we have to do is to close the gates so that no more calcium can leave. The ion channels in the sarcoplasmic reticulum are opened when an electrical signal passes close by to them. We call those voltage-sensitive ion channels. But these ion channels are interesting because they are going to close by a different mechanism. If you remember, there were three mechanisms by which an ion channel can either be opened or closed. One is voltage sensitive. The other is chemosensitive. The binding of a chemical messenger can change the shape of the protein and either open or close the gate. And the third, which is not really involved in this process, is mechanosensitive. But these ion channels are both voltage sensitive, they are opened by an electrical signal passing close to them, and they are chemosensitive, they're going to close when a chemical binds to them. In this case, the chemical that is going to bind is in fact calcium. So the calcium that is flowing out of the sarcoplasmic reticulum, much of that calcium goes into the sarcomere, but some of that calcium is actually going to bind to the very protein that allowed it out of the sarcoplasmic reticulum in the first place. And this is a form of negative feedback, if you recall back to the beginning of the course when we talked about positive and negative feedback. So you can see in this next picture how some of the calcium that has diffused out of the sarcoplasmic reticulum winds up binding right there to the binding site that I'm highlighting with the cursor. And that binding of the calcium to the protein changes the shape of the protein in a classic closing of the ion channel, of a chemosensitive ion channel. And you can see with the calcium in place, once again highlighting with that cursor, that has caused a shape change in the protein, and that gate is now closed so that no more calcium can come out. So that doesn't actually get the calcium away from the sarcomeres, but as long as the gates are open, trying to put the calcium back in the sarcomere is not going to be much good. It would be like trying to herd chickens back into an enclosure but leaving the door open. They would just come right back out. So that's the first step. The next step is to actually get the calcium ions back into the sarcoplasmic reticulum, and that is achieved through primary active transport. And if you remember to when we talked about molecular movement, primary active transport is a mechanism that moves a substance up its concentration gradient, that is, from an area of lower concentration to an area of higher concentration. Now, even though calcium has diffused out of the sarcoplasmic reticulum, there's still more calcium in the sarcoplasmic reticulum, or I should say a higher concentration of calcium inside the sarcoplasmic reticulum than outside the sarcoplasmic reticulum. So we're going to need to essentially pump that calcium back into the sarcoplasmic reticulum. And that is achieved by primary active transport. So we've already seen that one type of protein embedded in the membrane of a sarcoplasmic reticulum functions as an ion channel. This is a drawing that shows a different protein embedded in the same membrane, and you can see the phospholipid bilayer right here. And you can see that the way this protein is shaped is that it is open, or it's sort of a butterfly shape, so that the binding site is exposed to the outside of the sarcoplasmic reticulum up here, where the calcium that was in the sarcomeres is still floating around. Well, those calcium ions can bind to this binding site, at which point the protein is going to have to change shape so that it's no longer open to the exterior, but it's open to the interior. However, remember that we're moving a substance up its concentration gradient. And a concentration gradient is a form of potential energy. So to move a substance up its concentration gradient requires energy. Where is that energy going to come from? In primary active transport, it comes from ATP. So in this case, an ATP molecule breaks down so that the third phosphate in the chain is cleaved off, and that phosphate forms a chemical covalent bond to the protein. Of course, the adenosine diphosphate molecule, the ADP, floats away and is not involved further in the process. But the energy that's released when that phosphate is cleaved off of the ATP is transferred to the protein when that phosphate forms a chemical covalent bond to the transporter protein. And that energy is used to change the shape of the protein. Notice how the binding site is now exposed to the inside of the sarcoplasmic reticulum as opposed to the outside. So that calcium ion here that had bound to the binding site on the protein can now come unbound and is free to move into the interior of the sarcoplasmic reticulum. So it's the energy from the ATP that causes the protein to change shape, and ultimately that's the energy that is used to move the calcium ion up its concentration gradient. And then eventually that protein, that phosphate is cleaved off of the protein, and when that happens you notice that the protein changes back to its original shape, and this protein can then be used to move yet another calcium ion from the outside of the sarcoplasmic reticulum back into the sarcoplasmic reticulum, essentially getting it away from the sarcomeres and away from the actin and the myosin filaments so that the cross-bridge cycle can be interrupted again and the muscle will relax. So that is the explanation for how a muscle relaxes. At this point, we've talked about the cross-bridge cycle, the mechanism for contraction. We've talked about regulation of contraction, excitation, contraction, coupling, and then finally relaxation of the muscle.